the Fulani Nationality Movement, after extensive deliberation on the state of the nation in the context of recent killings and national uproar, met today in Kano, the capital of Kano State. Amongst other things, the Fulani deliberated on attacks on cattle by rustlers, kidnap of Fulani men and women in some parts of Nigeria, displacement of Fulani traditional settlements in the northern Nigeria and some parts of southern Nigeria, stealing of properties belonging to the Fulani cattle owners, amongst other issues. The group also deliberated on the political situation in Nigeria, occasioned by the irresponsible calls for restructuring of Nigeria, an historic and vicious attack on Fulani people by southern nationalities and their cohorts in the Middle Belt, the plot to ensure Fulani are pushed out to backbench in the power equation in Nigeria, and above all, the vicious campaign against the God-ordained place of Fulani as a leading star guard in Nigeria. And after extensive deliberation, we hereby make the following declaration. Listen very well. A. The killings in Benue State of the chief is well deserved. It was a revenge. It was a revenge attack on a series of onslaught on the Fulani, which most Herodians on November 17, 2017, where 30 Fulani men and women were killed in Nasarawa State. We noticed the recalcitrant culture of the chief people, as demonstrated even in the 1804 jihad, when they obstructed our ordained conquest of Nigeria. B. We condemn the media propaganda again to wage war against the Fulani and supported by Yoruba Igbo and their bigotry allies in the Middle Belt. That we are aware of plots by minority ethnic groups in the Middle Belt to attack Fulani settlements. D. That we have asked all Fulani across West Africa to raise money and arms to prosecute the oncoming war. We call on all Fulanis to prepare for this holy war. There is no going back. All over the world, Nigeria is the only country given to Fulani by God.
Oh yeah?
God punish them.
Here's something. This was a press conference held in Kano. And this is what it is before the media, it's on social media. E. We oppose anti-grazing laws which obstruct the ability of Fulani to move freely and stay anywhere in Nigeria. The Fulani, if not for the British, would have actually conquered the entire Nigeria which God has ordained as our dominion. That the cattle colony is the only solution to the crisis. You remember when the federal government brought the issue of cattle colony and Ruga, which we resisted here in Benue State. Whether the federal government or state government accept it or not, we must ask our Fulani herdsmen all over West Africa to move to Nigeria to penetrate every corner for the upcoming jihad. You see the reason?
Yes.
We have asked them to be armed, since it seems it is the only language that Nigerians understand. The Nigerian government has failed to protect us. So you see the narrative. We want those who oppose Fulani cattle trade to be cautious of the consequences. We are ready for the worst. We are prepared for war. There is hope for peace if and only if attacks on Fulani herdsmen stop and the Fulani is allowed to settle anywhere that the Fulani choose to settle in Nigeria. We are Nigerians and are free to settle anywhere we desire with our culture, our families, our commerce, and our values to the glory of Almighty Allah. Any attempt or attempts to reverse this demand will be met with holy uprising never before seen in the history of Nigeria, and in the scale compared to only with the 1804 jihad. A word is enough for the wise. The Fulani is capable of defending itself. Signed, Banu Salisu Amadu, National President and Secretary Umar Amin Shehu. There are many others that he did. This one I won't read them, but just read the headings of the provocation that these people have been given. One of it here, they say, Benue belongs to Fulani herdsmen by right of conquest. Benue has never been conquered by any Fulani man, as far as we're concerned, and as far as history is concerned. The jihad of 1804 was stopped here in Benue State. We do not allow it to go.
Major talks about killing your premier. Add on top of that the North's general hate of the East, and you can start to get the picture of the sort of tribal tension Nigeria was heading towards.
One thing I've noticed, Premier, while I've been here, is that Northerners seem to have, I might almost call it, obsession about the Igbos. Could you perhaps explain that to me?
Well, the Igbos are more or less the type of people whose desire is mainly to dominate everybody. If they go to a village, to a town, they want to monopolize everything in that area. If you put them in a labor camp as a laborer, within a year they will try to emerge as headman of that camp, and so on. Well, in the past, our people were not alive to their responsibilities, because you can see from our northernization policy that in 1952, when I came here, there weren't 10 northerners in our civil service here. Then I tried to have it northernized, and now all important posts are being held by northerners.
Is this policy of filling all key posts in the north solely with northerners and not with other Nigerians a temporary or a permanent one?
In actual fact, what it is a northerner first. If you can't get a northerner, then we take an expatriate like yourself on contract. If we can't, then we can employ another Nigerian, but on contract too. This is going to be permanent, I should say, as far as I can foresee, because it will be rather dangerous to see the number of boys who are now turning from all our learning institutions coming out with having no work to do. I'm sure whichever government of the day might be, it will feel rather embarrassed, and it might even lead to bloodshed.
Doesn't this damage the idea, sir, of all people in all regions in Nigeria being fellow citizens of one country?
Well, it might, but you are new to our region, but how many northerners are employed in the east or in the west? The answer is no. And if there are, there may be 10 laborers employed only.